And we're live.
Yeah.
Halfway through the week.
Yes, it is.
Toil and trouble. wicked bubbles. Hey, everyone. We are most definitely getting ready for another Linux weekly, daily, Wednesday. A little bit of a pre-show, a little bit of a warm-up. Seeing what's going on. I have spent 20 minutes listening to Pedro talk about his online racing adventures.
There's a lot of that.
That's one of the games he sank the most time into.
Yeah.
I do like racing games too. No level of margin either. What are you at, 400 hours?
552.
See, that
is
benefit of the doubt.
Hello, Arthurin. Hello, and love and hugs.
And you can only play for 2 hours contiguous at a time until the game kicks you out, because there's a bug in the original game. There's many bugs in the original game.
Okay.
But that one, it's a sync issue between the client and the server physics calculations, where after a while, you either start becoming slower, even though the TAC says that you're going at the exact same speed. You're not actually.
They should leave that in, though, because the longer you play, that's a self-correcting issue.
Yeah, so what they do is after 2 hours, the launcher just closes the game. It's like, nope, to prevent speed bugging, you have been dropped from the game. Okay.
I'm not going to say that's an elegant solution, but I would approve of that solution. Like, listen, it works, doesn't it?
Yeah.
They don't have access to the source code, so they can't actually find and fix the bug. All they can do is basically use a DLL injector that lets them add stuff and maybe circumvent certain things in the game. Okay. But yeah, they can't fix it.
Yeah, Arthur, and I haven't gotten all my parts yet. In fact, the power supplies are back ordered, so. And I need 3 of them because I'm also building a system for Steve Husband. So now I have 3.
Oh, is that how you convinced him to let you do that?
Yeah.
Now Steve's like, what? Sure. Okay. Power supplies.
Oh, hi, Jelly Bean.
I don't know. I am tempted not to say anything about power supplies because I needed a special power supply that I don't have a backup for this thread ripper.
Oh, yeah.
But outside of that one particular use case, probably have 6 modern power supplies.
Like, I'm
talking about 6
spare.
Yeah, I have 1 on my test bench.
Definitely, like not in other computers. I'm talking about just like stacked.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just got done using quite a few that some of my old machines, the power supplies died. Just replaced quite a few, like 3 of them recently. And I got to keep old AT ones around too for that reason.
I think the only AT power supply I have is I have 1,000 watt.
Bringing back that unicorn, Arthurin.
But that's legitimately for like the novelty of, like, see, they used to make 1,000 watt power supply way back in the day. Those are not new inventions.
Nope. I've got some of them here.
But the cruel reality is there's not really a modern PC. There's not a desktop. You're not... I mean, if you get 1,000 watt power supply, good on you, but...
Mm-hmm.
I say this as somebody with 1,000 watt power supply under my right foot, but you can get away without it. Because now, it used to be back in the day, if you bought a 1,000-watt power supply, you were like, maybe I can deliver 600?
Mm-hmm.
Fingers crossed. If you were lucky, you'd get 550, 575.
Yeah, no, now you have the 80-plus certification.
That's what I'm saying, man. I mean, yeah. If you get a 750, 750, you can get close to 6 out of that reliably without, like, sniff testing it constantly.
I have, yeah, my 750, 80 plus bronze is from 2014. And it started off in Portugal and has been in the UK for the past 3 years. There's that.
Yeah, Steve Hedsman, I wore one of my IT crowd shirts. I hadn't worn this one yet. Have you tried turning it on and off again?
Off and on. It's the only way around.
On and off.
Yes, turn it on and then turn it off again. There, yeah. Problem solved.
Also, yes.
Yes. We've all been there.
If it's not on, there's no problem.
That's technically correct.
Oh, definitely Darkwing. It's a classic. And it's one of the first times you actually got to see, you know, Ubuntu SIT stickers and, you know, the people that were working on the show, you know, knew Linux and knew how to get a hold of the merch.
How's the
taking swipes at Vista?
Yeah, yeah. I love how the set changes, you know, over the season. And, you know, like, never it was like it. the second season, there's swag everywhere. It's all, you know, I have that sticker from Scale and that one and that one and that one. You know, it's all the stuff I get at Scale.
The reason you haven't seen it, Ven, is because you were on it.
Also, yes.
The dude they keep in the server room.
What? Yeah, it's Ven basically knows him you. From the Mighty Boosh. He's the goth that lives in the server.
Yeah. They just keep me locked in here.
Yeah, that's good, Pedro.
Sometimes that light blinks. Wait, there it goes again.
Yes. I love that episode. I just rewatched it. Rewatched the series again. Yeah, Ven, that's you. You need to be watching IT Crowd. That is totally you.
That's what I said. Yeah. It's like, Ven doesn't need to watch it. He was in it.
Yeah. See, that's the problem. With not drinking, I can't dumb myself down enough to enjoy scripted television shows like that right now.
No, it's sorry. Quite clever. Really good humor. It's BBC after all.
I didn't stutter.
It's awfully poignant with whenever they do tackle the IT issues.
Yes. They actually have a reel-to-reel tape that answers the phone, and it says this. Yeah, it's still fresh even for today.
No, Daisy. Apparently it's on the Biebs.
It's ITV, yeah.
Oh. Did they do an American version of that show, too?
They were going to and didn't.
If they ever did, I'd never heard about it.
Yeah, Steve and I watched it when it was new on the BBC, because we bought the PAL discs, and I hacked our DVD player to play them, so... That's how we originally... Gosh, yeah, it's been a long time ago. So I still have the original discs.
Yeah, there's a decided... Well, I don't know. IT. What is that latest one? Next? Is that the series?
Next.
Yeah, that's a recent thing. I think they're like episode 3. It's like future tech IT drama scripted bullshit. It's one Google search away, Pedro. I assure you.
If I just Googled the word next, then that's not the first result.
Hang on. We gotta do this. Watch this. Let's see if Google's still functioning. Look at that.
Crime drama, science fiction. All right.
Yeah, the thing that's really cool about the IT crowd, Vin, is the humor. It's Graham Lyman. He's one of my favorite producers and writers.
Oh, it's Catch Fire, the first. Same usual plot.
Okay. Yeah, it is. Of course it is. I mean, it's made for the people who watch TV, man. Come on.
The civilian contractor joins the police to
watered down, homogenized.
Do something. Yeah.
The first series, and
yeah,
like
Father Ted, and
halfway through the second series of *Halt and Catch Fire* was pretty decent. It's a lot better than I was expecting. The only reason I gave it a chance is because it was an AMC. AMC, come on! I mean, *Preacher* and *Breaking Bad*.
Oh, Disney. Yeah, I'm not giving Disney money yet. Maybe when the second season of Mandalorian comes up, maybe.
Yeah.
I still have my sub. I've watched, I think, 4 episodes of Mr. Robot. I didn't tap out. I just, like, yeah, I'll get around to it.
I watched the first 2 seasons.
Hmm. Yeah, I've only watched
the finale of the second
season,
I was like, eh? I get exactly what you were doing, but eh? Really?
Yeah, okay. I heard a lot of people are very confused about that.
Oh, no. Again, I got exactly what they were going for. It's just, really? Okay, all right. I guess I'm out. I haven't seen the 3rd season yet.
But it definitely seems like it went on a good journey. You know, so
it goes places, yeah. And the comment of business dude's like, "Oh, I see you're using GNOME. I'm more of a KDE person myself." It's like,
yeah,
okay, fine, I'll watch. God damn it!
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything currently on the, is there? Is there anything worth watching right now?
Discovery.
I watched that.
I wonder if they can renew the contract of a bunch of different actors.
Yeah.
That's why it's starting like that.
Maybe. It's like, that was definitely an episode of something. I have the rule of 3. Always give it 3 episodes before you bail out on a project. What current thing are you watching, Jill?
Oh, boy. We've just been watching Star Trek reruns right now. Lately. But I have mostly YouTubers and vloggers and Linux shows, mostly what I'm watching. Watching a lot of Las Vegas strip live feeds, just because it's fun and to see what's open and what isn't and how things are going there. And because the Star Trek convention, of course, I was going to go to, is being postponed till next year.
And Daisy, to answer your question in general, yes. I have it running on Linux. I've been running it on Linux for the past 552 hours. Not consecutively, but
what do you mean? You gotta install Windows to play games, man.
The problem is that Lutris doesn't give you a way to easily update the version of Mono, because the launcher requires TLS 1.2, which Mono 4.9 doesn't support. So you need 5.0 something or 5.1 that's out now, installed, mm-hmm. and you have to update it manually.
How so would you ever do
Star
that?
Trek.
It's actually reasonably easy.
The new series is coming out.
Which one, Jill?
Specifically Prodigy, because it has Kate Mulgrew in it, Catherine Janeway.
Yeah, I mean, it's a weird time to be like, yeah, the new Star Trek thing. I was like, there's like three of them in the works, man.
Yeah.
The Captain Pike thing looks kind of interesting.
Yes, that looks interesting. And then, of course, they're going to bring Avery Brooks back, which is cool. I'm looking forward to all of them.
See, I'll just watch that. Just give me a Cisco show. I don't care if he's just like a raging alcoholic driving around the galaxy messing with things. Done. I'll watch it.
I guess maybe he's fallen out of his godship and he's back to being captain.
Well, when they left, he was a Bajoran god. So, yeah. It's like, did he get bored? Maybe he's just messing with people in the wormhole now. In fact, he's like a Q on a budget.
Yeah. So, yeah, Daisy. Actually, known about it for a couple months. Nickelodeon is working on a Star Trek show for kids. And the big news is they want Captain Janeway in it. So that's what I thought was really cool. And it could be interesting. I'm almost thinking it might be a little bit like a Sarah Jane's Adventures, you know, with Doctor Who, and this will be for the young audience and for Star Trek.
What do we think about, here's my pitch. We have a Cisco and Q buddy adventure.
I think Q and Janeway are better combination.
Regular cameos of Captain Worf.
Yeah, yes.
That'd be great, man. Admiral Worf.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Like, the three appearances of Q on Voyager were the only three watchable episodes of Voyager, period, man.
Well, there's been some really good episodes of Voyager. The fifth season is definitely... The fifth season is definitely my favorite. There's some Generation ship episodes, which actually are pretty cool. There have been, like, two of those. And I like all the Borg stuff, so...
Arthur, that's how you know it's not SDL1, because it wouldn't have full-screened into all three of your monitors. It would have full-screened to one and shut down all of the other ones.
Yeah, the clue is when they, like, two of the monitors go blank, you're like, oh, here we go!
It's like, alright.
Poor Arthur.
Do I have to just hit the reset button?
Oh, yeah.
I still maintain, like, the kind of thing to do for any game is to start Windows.
Yeah, that's I usually always do myself. Like,
give me the let me buy the ticket.
Yeah.
If I want to go on the adventure.
That's a kind of a bad habit that game developers picked up from Windows, because Linux doesn't have exclusive full screen, but they say, "No, we're rendering directly to the frame buffer." How about you don't?
Come on.
Yeah.
It won't hurt anything.
Yeah, sometimes you have to go into the configs and set it to windowed if it won't. Oh.
Which is why I like the Proton, as it currently stands. It doesn't give a direct frame buffer access to any of the games that you run through it. It always runs in that window, and it full screens that window. It stretches it out instead of resizing the monitor.
Yeah, and you can alt-enter, which is nice.
All right, so I'm going to get some drinks, so if anybody needs to get up, do your things, and we're going to come back and get underway.
Mm. Oh, yes, I guess I better do that. It's all on you, Pedro. The usual.
Oh, that's a 2FA code? Okay, I honestly thought that was just a Steam game ID. I was about to go look on Steam to see what that was. Let's see, what was it? Well, whatever that was on Steam, it's gone now. I have no idea yet, Artherin. That will be a question that once we're done with this, I shall ask Nora. It's like, what you want? Yeah, X-Radio 6 DGA, and seriously, good thing is that Unity actually does a very good job of not, if you're just putting out the Linux version by clicking the export button, it doesn't do full screen the stupid way, the Windows way. So it's, yeah. But yeah, no, the way Proton handles the, like, old games in low resolution, you fire them up, it's like, oh, it's 640 by 480. But it's got the pillar boxes down the side of the screen, and the game is effectively full screen. Or you could change a config and it'll try and stretch it to fit the monitor. That's amazing! Seriously! All games need to do that, not just the Proton ones, all of them need to do that. I don't know. What was it called? Perilous Warp? Perilous Warp. Are you sure that's from 2020? Because it doesn't look like it's from 2020. Well, it did come out in 2020, yes. But that engine doesn't look like it's from 2020. Yeah, no, that was a very good project, Mr. Alert. I remember trying it with the original release of Neverwinter Nights for Linux. It had a couple of bugs and it crashed if I moved the mouse, but it started at least. That was a very, very interesting bit of kit you were working on there.
Yeah.
Yeah, the SDLCL, what Mr. Alert was doing to translate SDL 1.2 to SDL 2.
That was rough, man. I'm glad they finally got his medication right and he gave up on that.
See? Differing opinions.
It's for his own mental health, man. You're not of sound mind working on anything like that.
Didn't Nicholas say that he was going to finally start work on that? What happened to that idea? I haven't been following his Patreon.
Listen, we both said things, okay?
I also remember when he was on the show that he said he wasn't going to do that.
Alright, so let me pull that up, and we... Oh, right. I could open that up.
Yeah, Free Jack, that definitely was an argument to be made when consoles had their own architectures. Nowadays, that's a bit of a harder sell. Oh, what does this game need to run? An AMD APU. Okay.
You're also dealing with APIs.
Yeah.
Because even on the Xbox, Microsoft's like, yeah, the X12, bro, and like, what does, like, PlayStation colors, it's like PS HL GL or so. I mean, yeah, you don't want to go that.
And the Switch is totally Vulcan, but not Vulcan.
Yeah. Well, Nintendo's gonna Nintendo. They're like, oh yeah, it's Vulcan, but not regular. I mean, come on.
It's really? Nintendo and Nvidia branded Vulcan.
I mean, outside of the one that's what respective vendors are going to force you to use, probably not. All right. Pull that down. That's good. What if we get? I don't think anything has been forgot. So we can start.
Microsoft ever decide to make Vulkan a stable of UWP? Maybe.
Oh man, I don't know. It's just Microsoft, man. Microsoft will get itself sorted. It's going to be another decade. And welcome back to Linux Weekly, Daily Wednesdays, where we can sit back, relax, take that midweek break, talk about some of the fun things that we've been going on in the world of Linux and open source. I'm Vin Stone, joined every week by Jill Bryant and Pedro Mateus, and everyone at home watching us live, listening to us after the fact. It's been a busy week. A lot of things have been going on, up to including the pure genius of my engineering.
Yes.
Behold,
the jank,
the pinnacle, the pinnacle of engineering excellence, Pedro.
We need Steve Husband to make you a case for that.
What are we looking at? You see, ironically, Pedro and I were talking about that earlier. With it's like, oh yeah, it's like, well, to put a point on it, we're talking about I made a Raspberry Pi camera because I'm sure everyone how easy they are to set up, and what I've done is just to fix the back of the case to the camera with the thing I like to call gaffer's tape or painter's tape. And we were talking, Pedro and I was like, yeah, you know, I could print out a clip and hold it, get it lined up, figure out what material I need and what the tensile strength needed to be, put it all together. And, you know, like I could be using that camera with little pieces of tape for like 16 hours before you got that figured out. So there's also that. Be on the lookout for it. I'll have that posted up probably by Friday. I'll have everything together. The whole point of this is I had four cameras hooked up to this box yesterday. I couldn't walk in here. It was danger. And doing a comparison, how to get the camera, pie, all that fun, with a high-quality camera, too, multiple lenses and all that fun stuff. Probably by Friday, I'll have that together and out for patrons. So look forward to that or in anticipation. I didn't fall or break anything, so I'll take that as a bonus.
Well, I know someone's disappointed already.
I know. Speaking of disappointment, what's going on, Pedro?
Not so much disappointment, but I did successfully manage to now figure out how to do the soldering with that teeny tiny little 8-watt USB soldering.
My boy, my baby discovered Flux.
Yeah, no, as it turns out, Flux is amazing. It also smells amazing. I really like the smell of hot Flux. I don't know why, but I do. And apparently it's really bad for you, so yeah. So I decided, you know what, let's find one of the slightly more complicated soldering kits for intermediate users. And I ordered one of these, which is like a
breadboard.
Yes, it is a breadboard, but it's what do you call the sand clocks? I'm missing a word.
The sand clocks?
Sand clocks, the ones that have sand hourglass. That you flip them. Hourglass, thank you.
Hourglass. Oh.
Yeah, it's basically got the hourglass design with those would be
see that.
Little LEDs.
Okay.
And yeah, it's got a lot of them to solder in, and a bunch of switches and buttons and a little microprocessor, which actually came with a socket. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me what's wrong with that socket?
Nothing. It's not missing a light. No, sir.
Yeah. So I looked everywhere in the bag and the leg was nowhere to be found. So I guess I'm putting the microprocessor directly on the PCB.
It's Well, I mean, it's not like you're going to fix. So is that going to have like some type of potentiometer or something to tell that it's been flipped? And
no.
No?
It just counts. I think it's 30 minutes one way, and then the LEDs start filling the other way after another 30 minutes.
Well, that's a bit disappointing. I knew you would get there eventually. But I will say, I'm glad you discovered Flux. Flux enables spray and play, pray.
But solder. It makes everything so much easier.
If you watch Lewis on his channel, I'm like, you know, technically, you can't really bodge that up, man. If I was doing like ball grid BGA stuff, I'd be drowning stuff too. But,
drown it in Flux and then wipe it off later with some isopropyl alcohol. Because, there, done. Yeah,
every time I use my hot air flow station, it's just like, it's usually an IC, it just goes, flies off. I'm like, okay, let me see if I can get that back on. What's new with you, Jill?
Oh, well, I am. My parts for my new mini ITX build are starting to arrive. And here's my 2700X. So that's going to be my mid range one. And then I'm going to build, like I said last week, a high end rig for my broadcasting rig after all the big announcements. So I'm looking forward to that. And I'm going to be building a new computer for Steve's husband. So he's excited too.
Did you finally find one of those Hot Wheels PCs?
Yeah, I actually have. I actually have the Barbie one. I do have the Barbie PC in my collection.
Finally, you need to gut it and make a modern, like sleeper cape. Put something there for
that's
Steve.
That's exactly what I have been wanting to do, but I'm not paying what they want for those cases.
Come on, they're brilliantly designed. They just stay nice and warm.
The Hot Wheels cases and the Barbie cases, they couldn't get rid of those. I mean, they used to be like $30 for a while around town.
That's because they were engineering junk. Like all the PCs
they were
died
badly
inside
made.
Of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good times. Badly made. Good
That's why Mattel got out of that.
Hey, let's get some Linuxy stuff because Susie needs some help.
Yeah. So this is... really wonderful. Would you like to contribute to a wonderful and friendly Linux distro?
I don't know. What if I got a problem with the color green?
Oh, I love the color green.
Wrong distro. And no Linux Mint or Ubuntu made for you either.
Okay. Aw. I have geekos, in fact, in this room. Stuffed geekos. So OpenSUSE is looking for volunteers. And they need volunteers for editing and writing for documentation and wikis. And also for creating video tutorials, including producing, scripting, editing. And, you know, they need someone out there who has the knowledge to do that and would be, you know, happy to contribute to the distro. And they also need volunteers for testing the software workflow and settings on new hardware and to make sure that their software works well on it and that it has a nice flow for what they want for their distro. So it's all good.
I'm definitely down with that, man. I'm all for, you know, if you use Susie and you want to lay down some knowledge and help some people out, give them a ring. They got Telegram, Discord, IRC, of course. Get in touch with them because, you know, people who can make Linux educational material for other Linux users, kind of rare. Always in short supply, so it'd be good if you get out there and give them a hand. Also, Pedro, they need translators.
Yes, they do. Because, as it turns out, if you keep adding new stuff, especially in the case of OpenSUSE with their tumbleweed distribution, there's a lot of new stuff. So, if you have translators and if you have... a contribution to make, ltenant.opensuse.org is the website that you should go to. I contributed a lot to Ubuntu Mate or the Mate desktop environment translations, but then there was an update and a bunch of things got added, and I looked and it's like, no.
Which is a perfectly fair response. Technical documentation is also very important.
Yeah. And you can also contribute to their get.opensource.org website. They need help with that as well. And possibly even to help them make some music videos. that they're known for.
See, I advise if just don't do it. Don't do that. That. No, the world has been provided with enough cringe on that aspect. Aww. Everything else, I'm 100% behind.
they've done some good music videos, so that's to promote.
Debatable.
Yeah, very debatable. Debatable.
Hey, I'm being positive.
I could be positive too, but I'm like, oh no, that's
no. The worst thing you can do to someone is damn them with fine praise.
Well, that's kind of the whole thing. You know, you don't necessarily want to run out on the front lawn and be like, the sun's square, because everyone's like, no. Okay, fine, whatever.
Tell an artist that something is good, but it actually is.
They're going to run right up to you and they're going to shake you, and you're like, good Lord, man, are you running plasma?
I am, actually, as it turns out. Yes. And there's a new version. It came out last week, but it was a little bit, you know, right then and there. So we decided to wait for this week. Plasma 5.20, it's new, improved, inside and out. So some of the issues or some of the up-and-coming interesting bits, like the Vulkan renderer and everything else, those will be for Plasma 5.21 or maybe later. This one is basically the ones we were talking about a couple of months ago that have basically attempted to reunify the entire system settings window, because they started to replace some of the settings widgets with the new QML based ones, and the that's what was making that noise. Okay. That was only mildly distracting.
I can cut it back on if it would please.
No, it's fine. the older versions that were still in there, they clashed a little bit, so they decided to unify all of that. And honestly, well, I did have a memory leak, a few memory leaks over the past couple of weeks, but that turned out to be the problem with Quantum. Mm. That's a rendering engine for Plasma, similar to the Breeze and the Fusion, and I don't think they use QT Curve anymore.
This looks like a video for people who know what kerning is.
It is a GUI, and they are trying their best to make sure that the GUI experience is as unified and feels as natural and as integrated as possible. And kudos to KDE, they've actually succeeded in a lot of that. Now they just need to work on fixing bugs, because they're still there. Mir pointed out the translation bug that keeps cropping up. That's been around since forever. You change the system language to, say, Portuguese, and then half of the system will be in English, while the folders that XDG can see, it's like, oh, your documents, everything else, that gets translated to Portuguese. So, yeah, no, that's been an issue for a long time, and they fixed it several times, and then they break it again. Hmm. So, it's teeny tiny little things.
Yeah. Well, I love the new wallpaper. Actually, the wallpapers from the last few releases, the
I like the beach
wallpapers.
One. That one was really
beautiful.
Nice.
Oh, yeah. That was, yeah, that actually was my favorite so
518,
far.
518,
yeah. Yeah. So, KDE has always been one of the best desktop managers regarding notifications. They've always done a really good job of that, and was way ahead of a lot of the other window managers because of that. And in this release, you actually get notified when you run low on disk space, which is very good, especially if you're working, say, in LibreOffice, and you know, you have a crash if you run out of disk space and you're trying to save a file. It actually did happen to me once, but now it'll notify you, so that you won't be in danger of low disk space. And what's also cool is you can now enter the Do Not Disturb mode by simply clicking on the notifications applet or system tray icon. Makes that much more convenient now. And some of the other desktop managers have started doing that as well. So it's really good.
All right. That's the thing. It's KDE. If it's your taste, go for it. And yeah, That's on you, though. Enjoy your translation. What about what was the last little bit about Waylon? Is it just 10 years away?
No, yeah.
At the bottom of the page.
In the works.
Or did you just tap out there? You're like, no.
No, I was looking at Discord because Nemo is wrong. And to your point, Nemo, go ahead and go to i10n.opensuzy.org. See what website you get. Okay. What was the question? Waylon support?
This is why you can't be within 12 hours of me. Yeah, Waylon support and KD. There was a mention at the end of the article.
There is, and there was a lot of work put into getting Waylon to work in KDE. You may even remember that there were NVIDIA patches submitted by NVIDIA themselves to make sure that the EGL streams bit actually worked. And right now, you can use KDE with Waylon, but there are still a number of issues and a number of known issues. There's a full change log. They have the link at the end there. And mouse and touchpad support aren't exactly on par with how they work and the acceleration and everything else. It's progress, I guess. I mean, it's not like Waylon is going anywhere. So
Waylon's pretty. I saw a mention earlier today that Electron is going to get Waylon powers.
Nah. That makes sense. Yes.
Exciting times, kids.
Yeah.
So why are we talking about a weather applet?
Oh, well, it's because this is my favorite one.
And correct. I use this. I know. Let me show you exactly why we're talking about this. Because it's got a bunny rabbit in it. That's the only reason we're talking about this.
Yeah. Aw.
I'm not hearing denial exactly is all I'm not hearing.
So this is WTT.in, I call it weather.in. And I've mentioned this before on LWW, but I wanted to go into a bit more detail because it's something I use all the time, and it's just a really cool feature and app. And you
can
run.
Is that like supposed
run
to be one bunny rabbit, or is that like two bunny rabbits, like on top of each other, trying to get into
a
theater?
Sun.
It's the big carcinogenic star in the sky.
That's a bunny rabbit.
So you can run weather.in in the shell by simply typing curl weather.in, or in a web browser at weather.in.
Weather.ham, just
and you can embed it as a widget on your desktop or website, or save it as a PNG. And just really nice, tons of functionality. You can write scripts for it, like I said, to put it on your desktop or as a widget. And it's just got has beautiful ASCII weather art as well, as Ben was showing. Ones that look like the sun looks like a bunny. And one of my other favorite things is you can configure it. Like, what no good weather app doesn't allow you to configure it. So this one, you can actually add the humidity for the day or the week, the temperature, even the moon phases, precipitation. So it just has a whole lot of detailed settings that you can use. And I love the layout. It's just an easy to read grid with, the morning, middle of the day, and night temperatures. And it's just easy and convenient, and I love it. I use it all the time. I even use it on mobile.
And being able to just curl WTTR.in and it goes, oh, you're here, are you? There's your weather.
Yeah,
that's nice. You don't
so easy
need anything else installed other than curl. Yeah,
that can be pretty handy, man. All I can say to that is, okay, Google, tell me about Bluetooth security. It seems like every year we're graced with a brand new security exploit for Bluetooth.
Yep, and it is Bluetooth. Mm-hmm. When you have something so ubiquitous, quiet like the Bluetooth, Yeah, it's bound to be exploited about as hard as it can. This one seems to affect BlueZ directly. If you have the Blues or Bluesy or however, I think I've gone through all of the variations at this point, so I've probably angered everyone. But Andy Nguyen managed to create a proof of concept, and there's a blog post with it, with basically being able to, within Bluetooth range, which, as we know, a Pringles can pointed at a laptop, increases the Bluetooth range significantly. but it's, yeah, you could effectively send arbitrary code and run commands remotely without any kind of user interaction. As long as the Blues daemon is running and Bluetooth is visible, you're vulnerable, basically. Now, this isn't as big an issue in the age of the pandemic, because no one, or far less people are going out to coffee shops and whatnot, so far less likely that you'll be vulnerable to this. But do keep your laptop and your phone, if Bluetooth is on, keep them invisible. Don't make them visible at all. I know that's a stupid default, and I know for a fact that KDE, for one, keeps crying at you if your computer is not visible via Bluetooth.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say, if you have Bluetooth enabled on your PC, that's your own problem.
Well, there's things that require Bluetooth.
Yep, that looks like a problem with a bunch of buttons on it.
Yeah. It's the nicest problem.
It's all yours.
Yeah, and some people use Bluetooth keyboard and mice too. So
see, that's 104 problems in one convenient little package.
Or 130 if you have one of the big ones.
Mine uses Wi-Fi, so ha.
Yeah, Wi-Fi direct.
Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, as Pedro just, you know, mentioned, it really, you know, if you're at home, this is not going to affect you really that much unless your family wants to hack your system and has the know-how to do it. It's actually quite challenging to do. So that definitely is a thing. And if you're out and about, say at Starbucks, not many people have the know-how to hack BlueZ, let alone a hack on Linux. So it's a thing, but you still have to be very careful because it is a very serious, actually, vulnerability for sure.
Just take care, make sure, like, especially if you're using a dongle, like, just put an extra layer of aluminum foil around.
Yeah, there you go. The PC.
Yeah, you can just make a channel of aluminum foil directly to your device, which then kind of defeats the purpose of the whole.
You know, it'd probably be a lot safer if we could, like put a wire on the Bluetooth, you know, from device to device. That would help.
Yeah.
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 Again, it defeats the purpose a little bit. But yes.
With the can at either end.
Somebody just tuned in right now and they're like, really? And I'm like, absolutely.
Yes. Yes.
Jammy is something we've brought up, but they have a, well, couple of updates.
Yeah, so Jammy is a peer-to-peer soft phone that we've talked about before, and it's also an instant messenger that has positioned itself as the free and open source alternative to Skype, which is a good thing. And it's actually been around a long time. You may have used it. It was formerly GNU Ring, and then before that, SFL Phone. And they have a new update. It's called Jammy, in quotes, Together. And their focus is not just on peer-to-peer, but on large group collaboration as well. So they've done a lot of improvements in that area. And they've also, and it's also been updated to work better on low bandwidth networks, which is really good for people that, for instance, are still on an older version of DSL or classic dial-up. And it's great because they got it down to 50 kilobytes in audio video mode and 10 kilobytes for audio only calls. And that's actually really significant. So they've done some amazing updates. There's a whole bunch of them. You can go through and read that article.
Very well done.
I've definitely played around with Jamie a couple times. Tried to take a Pepsi challenge even with this show because it can work with lower bandwidth. Also, it has the advantage of being able to take, make use of HEVC, H.265, which, man, come on, it's 2020. More things should take advantage of that bandwidth requirement-wise, because 265 is a straight-up dark art. Because if I record something in 265, it's a bear to work with, but file size, like being able to utilize that for streaming. The problem is the underlying tech's always been great. I've liked it. Forward thinking. But that client, man, that client would break in fascinating, entertaining ways differently on different machines.
Yeah.
I remember it was Ven, myself, and Jordan trying to set up Ring at the time to find an alternative because Skype for Linux was dying and we needed something. So it was interesting. It's like you had a bit of a launch procedure to get everything to work properly. And yeah, it would just give up halfway through, which was weird.
I'm always open to go back and play with it. I will say, if this reaches anyone working on the clients, expose a couple of things that are very important for doing what we do, and they're just nice options to have, is echo cancellation. Want to be able to kill that. Any type of audio processing that you're doing, make that an option so we can kill it. And it's pretty much it, man. It's basically the audio stuff. And we can play with it, see what the latency is like, and more options, more better. But
yes,
I like crazy stuff. This is some crazy stuff, so sit back and allow me to inject you with it. This is a VST server. What's VST? It's an audio plugin for you. Duh. Yeah, I know audio stuff. Go make some popcorn, get something to drink. I'm going to talk about it. This is Audio Gritter. It's a plugin host. Now, it's kind of different because you're thinking, well, you know, I can use Carla or something like that. And with like, I can run Wine to host my Windows VST 2s and 3s under Linux. This is basically going to allow you to turn Windows into a butter robot. And it's just going to live on your network only to host VST 3s that you can query and pull in with the Audio Gritter and drop that plugin itself into your DAW over your network. And then you can access all of those plugins. It's like, that's really neat. I don't have Windows and I don't have a bunch of Windows or Mac VST or any plugins whatsoever for those platforms because I'm me. But it's really like that can solve a lot of problems right there. And hey, man, I like the idea. And you can do this with OS X, but the joke doesn't stand so much. But being able to use Windows as a server, isn't that like a novel thing?
Microsoft did attempt at one point to have this whole server infrastructure built on Windows Server. Mm-hmm. Nowadays it's called Azure and it runs on Linux.
Yes.
It's really an issue because, you know, most of the plugins on Linux are LV2 and people are like, that's dark arts, moon magic, mainly because documentation for writing LV2. I know this personal experience. Is words I can't say on this show for family friendly, but they would be very apt description for the documentation for LV2. VST2s have been around. VST3 support isn't even in Ardour. Currently, it's only available in nightlies, and so they're still working through that. But this is like, boom, you drop that into a channel strip if you're using Reaper, Bitfig, or anything like that, and you can access all the stuff that you currently have. That can be a game changer for some people. Thinking about like, hey man, I'll give this Linux thing a try because it makes sense for a DAW, especially if you're on a Mac right now. You're looking for plan B. Let's be honest. Maybe Windows doesn't sit with you for a bunch of reasons. Well, hey man, come on over. But let's keep the audio train going because when I talk about audio stuff, both of these, they just check out. So I got to carry everything by myself. This is Interfacing Linux, man. This is a series I do just mainly because no one else is going to do it. where I'm just taking the Pepsi challenge with a bunch of old audio interfaces, FireWire, because you know what? AD conversion, preamps, those have been sorted for about the past 15 years. And you can buy some very high quality equipment for pennies on the dollar, because Windows and Mac, they've bailed on FireWire, and we have FireWire support for audio interfaces directly in the kernel that shims. Now, I don't necessarily use it at this point. It's still immature, but it is available through Fado as well. So I take these devices, I plug them in, find out what they can do. Speaking of documentation, horrible documentation on what works and what doesn't with Linux. And this was for the Focusrite Sapphire Pro 40. I went through that. I like Focusrite. Focusrite is like Behringer. They make cheap but usable gear. And Focusrite's way better at marketing. Because somebody's like, oh, I wouldn't buy Behringer. I bought this Focusrite. And I'm like, you realize that is the exact same thing with a different paint job, right? No, it's not. You don't know what you're talking about.
I paid more. Therefore, it's worth more. Exactly.
I overpaid by 15%. It's clearly better than stone. You don't know. So I test these things, man, see if they work out of the box, what works, what we can fix, and can it be usable? I really wish I could tell you that. I even do, look, science testing. I'm doing round trip latency, man. this I kind of walked into, you know, there's my verdict. There's what you should do. There's a reviews like mechanism I put into our website because, man, Pedro will love that. He'll get a lot of use out of crickets. And, just to let you know what works, what nopes. And I wanted this because I know it's getting really hard to get a hold to pandemic and all that fun stuff. Audio interfaces, like cheap ones, like, hey, I just want like a little 204 or an I2I or 2I2. And it's like, well, maybe you can pick up something a lot better on the cheap. Not this one. This one's got a critical flaw in it. But if you want to find out what it is, you can head over to our web zone and find out. Look at that. That's evil what I just did, but I just did it, didn't I?
consume more of our content.
That's correct. Yes. You'll never know. Or if you'll be like me when somebody pulls that on me when I'm listening to a podcast or watching a video, it's like, I guess the world will never know, man, because I'm not
gonna, don't care enough to look it up. Go on.
No, it's not even that. It's the contrarian part of my makeup, my design. I'm like, I want to know that, but I'm not going to go look because I'm going to teach you a person who'll never know.
Okay.
secrets.
We get to talk about, Microsoft?
Yes.
It's a big Microsoft Hard Linux segment this week.
It sure is.
Ladies and gentlemen, Microsoft a couple of months back threatened to do something. It was an idle threat. And we said no. And I, to my credit, I was like, I'll put some money on that. We'll see before Christmas. Like what? 2 months ago, Redmond came out and they're like, you're going to see it before October. I'm like, okay. Well.
It's October.
It is my responsibility, nay, duty, to report to you, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, zombie demon hordes of the internet, Edge on Linux is no longer an idle threat. That's right. It's thing. You can download it. I don't know why you'd want to, but go ahead. We can finally harness, as Linux users, we can finally harness the power of Chromium under Linux. It's going to be a new experience for a lot of us. Debs or RPMs, take your pick. That's great. It's pretty easy to get set up, allegedly. Pedro's going to chime in on that. Now, which I didn't know what I was looking on, the dev channel is live, which is like the nightly channel, and the beta channel will be coming soon, which is like the monthly updates or something like that. And there's a giant square because I have, oh, it's a video. Hang on.
Yes.
Introducing my, that, nah. No. I'm going to be the better person.
But yeah, no. So who's down for a snowball fight in hell? Because yeah, no. We've seen Microsoft promising or threatening, as the case may be.
See, now every time Pedro does that, I have to go like this extra step through the YouTube thing. And I'm like, oh, great. Okay. It's like this extra like menu thing I have to go through.
Heck.
It's too late now. I really gotta do it.
Yeah.
I mean, you might as well just start stripping.
Oh.
Oh, no, we're on Twitch right now. I can't. No, it's, I did try it. I tried it. I downloaded the deb. I tried, that's another thing that KDE is currently broken in KDE, it's Discover. If you try to install a deb using Discover GUI, it doesn't. So I used EPKG like a sane person, and wouldn't you know it, it installed just fine, started it up, yep, that looks a lot like Chrome with a Microsoft do-over. And I went to, of course, I had to go into help about and see the versions, like, yep, Microsoft Edge version 80, blah, blah, blah. And yeah, that's it works. It seems to work very well. I played some YouTube videos.
Did you really walk up to the house, kick the door, and be like, "All right, how did you guys manage to break Chromium?"
I wanted to see if something was like really, really busted, or if something just straight up didn't work on Linux. But no.
I poked
at the settings. I changed the language.
That you were downloading and installing it, and I never saw a screenshot in our Discord of our web zone. I was just I crawled into a corner, cried myself.
See, I didn't want to subject the server to that, but
that's Cloudflare, no. Bobby. You're not getting to the server.
What I tried was something that Chrome for Linux doesn't actually let you do, which is change the language, because Chrome on Linux is objectively inferior to the Windows version, because the Windows version, you can pick whatever language you'd like to use. And for Linux, it picks automatically. Mm-hmm. But it's a bit stupid, because say you have your desktop in, say, default or standard Spanish or standard Portuguese, it defaults to their American counterparts. So Chrome is dumb.
Maybe, in that respect, it could be advanced. It could default to country of origin.
It could. It doesn't, but what it does right now is not very good either. And that's something that I absolutely have to give Microsoft props to. You can pick the language. Is that so hard, Google?
Yeah, true. Well, I found it weird. I downloaded the deb also on Ubuntu, and I found it weird that your sign-in to your account is your Microsoft account instead of Google, and it's just strange to see that on a Chromium-based browser.
Use that old Hotmail account.
Yes. And it's nice when you launch it. It gives you three options for page layouts. One is focused, the other is inspirational, and informational. Or you can customize it. I liked the inspirational layout because it's kind of similar to the Bing search. That's one of the few things I like about the Bing search is they have really pretty background pictures. And as a search engine, it actually works quite well. And it was also released for Android in the Google Play Store as well. And I tested the Google Play version, and it was set up very nicely. The hamburger menu was on the bottom of the screen, and it was really easy to click on the hamburger and rearrange the menu with drag and drop because it's in a grid style, which was really a nice feature. And it was easy to do. And so far, to me, it seems really zippy. It loaded up web pages really quick, and I went to linuxgamecast.com. It loaded it really quick, and I've been impressed by it. So very nice,
Microsoft. I'd just like to point out the words spoken by one Jill Bryant not too long ago. Okay. Bing is actually a pretty good search engine.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I am more curious about this Microsoft account. How does that? Do you need a Microsoft account to use it?
You don't need a Microsoft account to use it. Much like you don't need to log into Chrome to be able to use it.
Now, here's another question.
If you want to sync.
Yes, sync. Is there the equivalent of like Chrome Sync or Firefox Sync?
Yeah.
But it uses Microsoft's
Now on to question three. How's the extension game work?
You can enable Chrome cross compatibility, so you can just go to the Chrome store and install it.
So it's like using Chrome with a bunch of extra steps thrown in and some functionality removed.
Arguably, there's more functionality.
Oh, so you're defending Microsoft? Understood. Yes.
Like I said, arguably.
It's there, man. It's not as disturbing as this next bit of kit.
Yeah, no, the next bit is also just as interesting. It's a snap! You can tell it's a snap because this comes from snapcraft.io. And this is the Windows calculator that was basically ported because the source code was released on GitHub not too long ago. And fine enterprising people behind the Uno platform decided, you know what? We have this platform that takes .NET and Mono, basically C-sharp applications, whatever they happen to be built on, and makes them run on whatever operating system, be it on .NET in Windows or Mono for macOS and Linux. And, well, they grabbed the source code from GitHub and made the Windows calculator work on Linux. It's only currently available as a snap. Boo. So I will not be putting this to the test, but it that's like the platform, the idea behind the platform seems sound.
Wow. Yeah. Well, actually, back in the day, I used to use the Windows calculator all the time, especially in the Windows 3.1 and 95 days. But now, really, I just use gcal command in the terminal or the Google calculator in Google search. But it is really, really cool that you have another option other than Electron wrapping all the things. You can use Uno instead. And that language seems really good. I've been hearing a lot of good things about it, and the developers really like it because it's so easy to port from one platform to the next.
Calculators used to be a thing. They used to be like moderately critical. One of the things that you would make sure that you had access to, like calculator with a K.
Yeah.
It's called K-Calc nowadays, but yeah.
Yeah, K-Calc is another one.
And then you could throw it in scientific mode, make people think you knew what you were doing, which nah, man, just like some basic stuff. I think like the most of humanity, the second it was available or made aware to me that I was like, wait, I just key this into the search bar on Firefox or Google, done.
Like, yeah, yeah. Google. It made it so much easier.
Oh, man. If you like what we do and you want to help make what we do so much easier, look at that segue. You can't beat it. We're talking about patreon.com/LinuxGamecast. That's where we hang out. That's how we pay the bills. But we like to give you a couple of sweet, sweet rewards. Yes, prizes. Yes, prizes. Does that sound right, Pedro? Prizes?
I mean, it could be punishments.
Pedro Mateus, whatever you're into. Punishments. Pedro is his own prize, man. We get a bunch of different levels up to and including advisors helping make this show possible. That is brilliant. I want to thank each and every one of you. That's cool, man. We get to do this the way we want to do it. We're not singing and dancing in any particular way to anyone else's song. And we get to do things like Jordan's like, I want us to try to do this. Like, this is the entire management structure we're allowed to have. But Jordan's like, oh, do it. Oh, okay. You didn't have to tell me. Just do it.
Yeah. No, stuff like who that. Was it that posted on Discord earlier in the week? Something about Jeremy Clarkson and his brief stint as a video game journalist. And something about, it's like Top Gear, but for video games, about the rash of TV programs here in the UK. There's already a sort of Top Gear, but for Linux news and for video games. Right here.
Yep. I don't like your analogies. They're terrifying. I think it's probably one of the worst analogies.
Yeah. Hey, I'd like to work with Jeremy Clarkson.
Apparently him and James May are really awesome people. I hear mixed things about Hammond.
Yes, same here.
So speaking of our Discord, man, if you want access to our Discord, you can get that by becoming a patron. There's a couple of other things, man. Access to the show notes. You get a custom RSS feed. If you like what we do here, like what we do Saturday, or if you just want to hear us chat longer and you're listening to the regular show, check it out. There's like 3 and 4 hour versions, along with video versions of the uncut episodes, background music. I know that's important to me. That's why I make those available, because I want people talking about something I'm halfway interested in, but not too much to where it's distracting. So I kind of keep that available for everyone. What else do we have? Oh,
We have plenty of thanks to give out this week.
Yes,
I got this
sure
wall
do.
Behind me, man. This is fine, upstanding cannibals. That's what it stands for, you weirdos. Quit thinking it means anything else. I don't understand what's wrong with the people. But these are the list of people that you can't read because it's blocked out by the glare. I know. And if you picked up anything from the Wish Zone, we got a studio list on Amazon, man. But like just stuff I'm planning on picking up. For the studio, and last week, just casually, so you notice I'm not mentioning anything this week, because last week it bit me, because I was like, hey, Pedro, yeah, you play with the like little computer stuff, man. It's like, what do you think of this cooler, man? Like, do you think that'll work with Jackbox? Because I was looking for, you know, a water solution. I had a Hyper 212 on Jackbox, which is a Ryzen 1700 OG. And like, maybe because after an hour or two, that 212 gets warm. It starts making a lot of noise. Fill some time, Pedro. I need both hands.
See, I was also going to reach into my drawer here. Take your mind out of the gutter, people. Mm-hmm. And grab my Hyper 212.
There you go.
That will save me from grabbing mine because... We got to thank Arthur, and this showed up like surprisingly, and I was like, okay, I got to try this out. If you are curious, this is from Corsair. The my running joke was, oh, this is a Corsair product in a Corsair case. That's probably not going to work. Or it won't fit. But it does. This is a single like 120 little rad AIO, and it can keep a Ryzen 1700 at 60. Again, this is one with, like it's just permanently clocked at 3 gigahertz. So there's your information. But thank you for that, sir. And it is most definitely, I was able to unplug two of the 140 fans in that case.
Nice.
So it brought the Wish down quite a bit. And I think I've mounted it in such a way so when it eventually leaks and tries to kill me, it will only just like get the bottom of the case one. Yeah. But to Pedro's point, Pedro, I pulled the 212 off. They do mount like the two. If you have a AM4 adapter kit for the 212, yes, they make those. Screw on both sides. Same idea, because I opened the box and I saw like back plates and I was like, this thing's never getting installed. I love you. It's like, I don't feel like pulling the motherboard out of this box, man. But those are for the Intel solutions. And it just screws in, tighten it in.
AMD's got a really nice backplate out of the box on most of those motherboards. That's nice.
I was very happy with it. So thank you again, Arthur, and keeping Jackbox nice and cool. And if anything ever happens to it, it's now your responsibility. It will be your fault. So you probably want to. update your will, because you might grossly underestimate the lifespans of ends. I mean, your great grandchildren's children just inherited this problem. No, but thanks, man. That's really cool. I dig it. And merch. Let's see. Are we done shilling
merch?
Yeah. We got lots to do for a couple of more people.
We don't have pants. We're going to get to it. I got to get this out of the way before we put a pin on it. But stickers, shirts, and all that fun stuff. But to Pedro's point, the Hyper 212, I put it up. Of course I did. Because that's not something you don't get. Speaking of family heirlooms, it's like this was your father's 212 and his father's before him. And they're still going to make an adapter that fits on whatever Laser 7 processor is available. And it's going to work too. That's going to be the thing.
That's not going anywhere. It's working really well.
Yeah.
So it's.
Yeah.
The Hyper 212 serves as a testament of like, don't over engineer something on accident because then you just buy the one. But we need. Think we have some new patrons.
We have Lord Mocha, our new patron, one of our newest patrons, as well as Daniel, which is another new patron. Yay.
And Daniel. I think Daniel's coming back, but that's awesome.
Yeah,
that's cool, man.
Okay,
that's awesome.
We also need to thank Zhao He, our latest Twitch sub. He subbed during the show earlier. You probably saw it. So no, we weren't ignoring you.
We saw you.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. Thank you. Are you sure the man, any letter in that Zhao could be silent, would mess with it at all, would it? Ah.
No.
All right. That's cool, man. That's kind of brilliant. Seriously, thank you all for letting us do this. Also,
they're all crazy.
They are, man. Fiscally responsible. Like, we've set up like multiple testaments of fiscal responsibility to like display.
And people take us up on it too. It's like, oh, is that a challenge? Is it?
Like, boom. That's kind of brilliant, man. But hey, it keeps us from like doing the Shaka Jivathon of like, in this episode, bro, I can't wait till the first time that appears at the beginning of a podcast. We're like, oh, you've sold out. I'm like, it costs money to do this, bro.
yeah.
If it didn't cost anything, man, I'd be the first person to do this absolutely for free. Our goal is to break even. So that's a very weird business structure, by the way.
I know. Yes.
So let's get in. Oh, also, if somebody buy Pedro a new microphone or I'm going to kill him. A slice of pie.
No. I thought it was okay.
Oh.
Am I dancing around too much in front of it? Is that the issue?
No, I just, trust me, I'm going to get you something for Christmas.
Okay. Well, I look forward to it, whatever it may be. The slice of pie this week is actually smaller than the Microsoft Heartlytics segment, which is odd. It's one of those weird episodes. But no, we do have some news on the Raspberry Pi proper, which is the compute module 4.
There's my interest. You give me that big breakup. And I was like, oh, the compute module, that's great. How much is this breakup board? $600? No, I don't know.
It's probably not going to be that much. The compute module itself is actually pretty cheap. It's $25, and you get the exact same SoC, Wi-Fi, everything else that you would get with the regular Raspberry Pi 4. Mm-hmm. But it comes in the compute module format.
Help me out with this part, though, Pedro. 32 variants. Does this thing come in, like, lemon cream? Mm-hmm. Or one. What are we talking about?
The variants come from, you can pick the RAM from 1 to 8 gigabytes, and you can pick whether or not it has eMMC storage built in to the compute module.
Okay.
Like anywhere, you could have none. You could have 2 gigs, 4 gigs, 32 gigs, what have you. So yeah, there's a lot of combinations you can do between 32. Exactly. The interesting bit is how this particular compute module differs from the previous one, because the compute module 3 was a DDR2 form factor. It's like an SODIMM, like a RAM stick for a laptop. That was the form factor. This one, it has two interesting connectors at the bottom, which are basically, if you had an old Dell laptop with an E-series port, it's a lot like that. It provides direct access to the PCIe bus of the SoC, and you plop that into that baseboard that has the full-size HDMIs and a bunch more connectivity and everything. I want one of those, and the compute module to go with it, because that looks really nice. I want to play with that.
How much? Okay, I want that board, but I want that board where I can just take a Pi 4, flip it upside down, and stick it in it.
Someone will probably make an adapter for those connectors to the GPIO pins.
Because I want that PCI hole, that buy one PCI hole, because do you know what I can put in that?
A lot of things.
Fire
capture
card?
I don't know. Fire or firewire card.
I can spec out and build a like super affordable Jackbox.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm just saying, be careful, Frosty. I might be like, yo, I need you to like open source 3D print like some designs, man, so we can have one for the masses. What?
the compute modules, the whole idea behind them has always been very interesting, and they keep improving. They change the form factor from one to the other, which kind of makes sense. And the connector actually reminds me a lot of the connectors for eMMC modules in the Pine books. It's just longer. So that's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
these have always been interesting. So
yeah,
I want to play with that big board. I want, you know, if you're just going to give me a PCIe hole is better than none.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely nice to have a refresh. It is a little sad though for people who have the projects they've already used the compute module in with a SODIMM. So, but this is so much faster, and they can adapt it. It's even smaller and has more on it. So that is cool too.
And it has the Wi-Fi's and the Bluetooth and everything else built into the compute module.
Into it, nice. Yeah. Has a lot of advantages.
It's pretty cool. All right. Maybe you have some questions, thoughts, hints, allegations. That's right. We're getting ready to wrap this up. You want to contact us and you don't want to mail us a pie. You just want to mail us a question.
I mean, if you'd like to mail Ven a actual physical edible pie, make sure it contains no meat.
Also, it's going to have to fit in like the smallest P.O. box too, because that's what I have. And that thing's still like $30, man. So
and yeah, it can't the have best sugar. Way...
So no sugar for Jill, no meat for Ven. Me, I'm not fussy, just give me pie. The best way to get in touch with us is to go to linuxgamecast.com. You hit the contact button. There's a little form you need to fill out. Make sure LWDW is the show that you're sending your feedback to. Someone is very, very likely to see your feedback if you send it there. If you leave us a comment on YouTube, yeah, we'll probably see it. We don't get those many comments, so it's fine. And now I have that song stuck in my head.
You're welcome. I want you to be hot, possibly sticky sweet.
It is pretty warm in here because that door is closed.
Do you hear that, Nori? Are you listening? Hose them down, cover them up, and kick them out front.
Aww.
Actually, it'd be pretty nice to be standing around outside now because it's chilly outside.
No, it's nice. Going to be brilliant. He's going to be curled up into fetal position on his lawn licking himself. It's going to be adorable. You'll be covered in sugar. Don't worry.
Oh, right, because of sugar. I've forgotten about that.
See, attention span of a gnat. That's why we love it.
Goldfish got nothing on me.
Feedback this week. First bit from Daniel. Man, what's it say, Jill? I can't read.
It says, thanks for mentioning the article, guys. I'm going to keep running with... Uptime birthday, hashtag uptime birthday. Daniel, it comes to us from Daniel Rosehill. Because last week, we talked about his article about Ubuntu backups and the tools he uses in the software. So, and it was really well done. So he contacted us on YouTube, as well as me on Twitter when I did our big tweet for the show. And we had a really nice conversation going back and forth. And I'm going to keep up with his tweets on his backup solutions. They're very informative and really good ideas. It's something that everyone really needs to do is to have three backups of everything. And thank you, Daniel. As the person on the internet who
coined the term YOLO raid.
Yeah.
That's a good article, man. Uptime birthday. Yeah, go rock it out. Sometimes it can be an army of one. That's awesome.
And if that's been working for you and you've sort of interiorized that whole thing or internalized.
Interiorized?
Yes.
You gotta quit licking so much sugar.
The problem is, I got up at 7 a.m. and I'm still not awake. So,
I understand.
Yeah, it's, if that's been, you know, if you have that muscle memory and you have that kind of workflow that it does fit in with that kind of backup schedule. Yeah. Hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What do we have up next, Pedro?
Up next, we have Bobby.
Bobby.
And Bobby has got something to tell us, or to tell you specifically, Ven. I'm so happy I found your channel. I was trying to find some sleeper FireWire devices I could try on my Ryzen 3800X.
Sleeper devices, like we're talking about cars.
It's old junky looking PCs.
That's what the kids use. It's like, it's my sleeper built. And I'm like, oh, okay, I see what you're going for. Never mind, just shut up then.
Yeah, it's like the old cases when you had the main box in Tipsy Danger.
Like, oh yeah, I remember 1995 when I was doing that with 486s and putting iPods in there. Yeah.
So he's saying that he used an Apogee Duet before with his old MacBook Pro, so what, he feels it's a good Apoogie? Time. Yes, an Apoogie.
Apoogie.
So he feels good about the quality of the sound and will look out for a deal. Also saw a pre-Sonus review from you, Ben.
Yeah.
The thought of possibly having 8 channels of 96K.
I'm not sure.
Yes. 96K, ADAT, SBDIF, and possibly, maybe, hopefully, MIDI for under $100 is such a steal. Used a Focusrite 2i2 Gen 2. Yes, for a while, and right now uses a Yamaha MG10XU mixer, has his USB in and out for monitoring. Anyway, I have to dig deeper into your content. Thanks for making these. Bubba.
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 Bobby.
That's why I make them. That right there.
See, I don't want to say Bobby because that's a very common dog name in Portugal. So it's Bobby.
Hey man, in all seriousness, I'm glad somebody found that's, you know, I do some, the entire series is for a very, very small niche, but it's definitely a niche of people who are looking to get away from Windows or get away from OS X or just something different. That avenue needs to be there to say, hey man, I'm thinking about switching over to Linux. Are the tools that I need available? The documentation for Linux with audio production, especially, like, hey man, I can save you some money. Come over to Linux. Let's take advantage of this. Because like I said, this hardware's, nothing's wrong with the hardware. It's just the interfaces has changed. Everyone's moved to Thunderbolt. Well, there's USB interfaces, but those are Tinker Toys. Oh, I just made some people mad. I want to get that information out there. And just, hey, man, that makes it worthwhile right there. Because, you know, these are never going to be like high traffic videos or anything like that. They're there for, I always wanted to start some of these videos off with, haven't you performed an interesting query?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's brilliant, man. Thanks for taking a look, and hopefully you'll like get into Linux music maker, just into Linux, man. Come on, we gotta give them gateway drugs. We gotta have different like things to throw out there and like reel them in, because it works better than you should just Linux. Like, but what about, nope, you need to Linux. That person's gonna quit listening to you eventually.
Yeah,
well, beautiful people, we've run out of time, so we got to roll the credits.
Yeah. Aw, thank you to our new patrons, Lord Moko and Daniel. And to our Theron once again.
There was a pronunciation guide for Lord Joe Moko here earlier.
Mocha? I don't know.
Joe Hey. Not Joe He, so okay, my bad.
Jao Hey.
Joe Hey.
Okay.
Jao awesome. Hey.
Yay, we love you all.
Thanks for the pronunciation guide, that was very useful. Yes,
that's definitely
very handy for Pedro. Pedro's like wanted to make sure so he can avoid ever saying it that way again. That's how Pedro works.
My name's not Venstone, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
Yes,
Venstone ways to give you 3 pronunciations.
We need to get Liz back on the show at some point.
Beautiful people, we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. 'LWW meanderings. The show.
Oh, come on. That was an hour-long show. What are you talking about?
Yeah. Yes. That was fun, though. We were all over the place.
Yes. Discord is bridged to Twitch and to IRC. So if you'd like to get in touch with us, type. IRC, Twitch, just start typing. Someone will be there to answer.
Yeah, Theron, unfortunately, the end of October, because I ordered them, and then I got a notice, oh, they've been back-ordered, they're out of stock. I hate that.
Speaking of back-orders, Pedro.
But I do have, you know, test ones I can use.
What's the latest update?
There isn't. Last time I asked was a week ago, and they said going to be another 1 to 2 weeks because there were delays in shipping. Okay, I'll wait another 2 weeks. If it doesn't, I'll be back. So, yeah.
Nice mirror, 730s.
So, Nemo, what did we learn today?
That arguing with you will lower your own intelligence?
You said it earlier. It's L10N, I18N.
Don't argue with people on the internet, Pedro.
But I like that.
I know you do. Depriving you of joy makes me feel better.
You don't say.
That is an untrue statement. That would require me to care.
But you will do it if it doesn't involve a whole lot of trouble.
Now, that's more to amuse me, though. I'm not really... Like, if there's no humor in it, I'm like, yeah. I don't know, man. I feel bad for Susie because the only thing I know about Susie comes from Patrick and Michael, and either Susie's like genuinely broke or those are like very technically incompetent Linux users.
No.
It's got to be one of the two, man.
Clearly, it's not for me because every single time that I've tried Susie, I couldn't get away fast enough. When my brain clicked into what I needed to do everything that I'm used to doing in other distributions with minimal hassle, it's like, and we're out.
The only time I've ever used Susie, I know I've said that, this was like back maybe 99, 2000. They were one of the first distros I ever saw with a network install, and I had one of those cable modems, so it was feasible.
Yes.
And I say, I gotta try that out. How does that even work? And yeah, it worked.
Yeah, I still use it on one of my servers, and I have it on a laptop, actually the latest version on a laptop. And I like it. Yeah, it does have a different workflow from other Linux distros. But once you get used to it, it's easy. I like Zipper. I use that a lot. You can use Troubleweed.
No, give me Fedora, I'll put up with, well, now that KDE Neon is a thing and it comes without a lot of the Ubuntu cruft preloaded, like, most of it's not there. It's just KDE and the kitchen sink to run it. It doesn't even have most of the KDE stuff pre-installed. It's just as bare bones as you can get. So it's a very nice starting distro for you to just rip out KDE if you don't want it and install XFCE.
Mm-hmm. You could just like install Debian.
Oh, Yast. Yast is really good for that too.
You could.
It'd be like removing one extra layer of abstraction, though, wouldn't it?
It would, but you're already using Debian, and Debian doesn't really speak to me. Fedora, on the other hand, I like very much. Wait, I would be using Fedora if it weren't for the fact that Jordan's already using Fedora.
Well, that's kind of the thing. You're already using Debian right now.
Yeah. Yes, we are.
You're using Debian with training wheels.
Yeah.
It's Debian Brown Edition. Well, yeah. It's not brown anymore, but it's like orange and purple. But, yeah. Yeah, and I've given a choice, Fedora, always.
Fedora's fine. I grew up with Fedora, and just, I guess, like, as a victory lap of, like, get off my lawn, I set everything up in here with Scent. Like, I could do that.
I have a laptop running Scent.
That's cute.
Yeah, Free Jack, I had to make sure it worked. As well.
And got Steam working on it, and got a couple of games working on it. So I was like, okay,
Steam's
that's
easy.
Done.
Sent that's Flatpak.
Negativo made it real easy.
Yeah, Pop! OS has it's my like, favorite implementation of the new GNOME. Definitely.
When you start compiling Jack, that's when you start getting in the weeds.
Yeah, no, I remember just, I knew that Negativo had the Sent and RHL repos for Steam and everything that it needs. So I just went to the website, it's like, install this, install this, install this, load this repo, install Steam. Oh! Hey.
Okay, J-O-E, but I know that's the wrong pronunciation. Pedro just said it earlier, and now I've forgotten it. So, I'd have to go back and chat and look. But anyways, yes.
Jiao-hei.
We gotta get that microphone like slid over to your right just a little bit.
Oh.
Yeah. You've been talking across it for a couple weeks, so. But you change, because sometimes you talk across it, but then sometimes you aim right at it. Then you go back to it. Mm-hmm. It's when you're reading the show notes, you have it lined up. So when you're reading your show notes, that you're talking directly into it. And as when you're not reading out the show notes, you're talking over the top of it.
Surface 3, I would like a Surface x86 tablet to install and play with Linux on it.
I can get you an RT tablet. Not...
No, I specifically said the x86 ones.
I got a Sharpie.
You're going to draw the traces on the motherboard to make an x86?
No, I'm going
to
make it. Listen, man, I'm gonna write x86 on it.
No, I want it because that is an interesting device to have that kind of computer in a form factor like that. It's interesting. And
Chipsy, I know you didn't just ask why it's talking over the top of a microphone bad. I know you didn't. If so, give me your car keys. You're not allowed to drive anymore. I don't want you on the road.
Chipsy, I honestly don't know why it would be such a bad thing to talk over top
Listen,
of a microphone.
Man, you know, if you're talking over the top of a microphone, I don't understand exactly what the problem would be. No, I mean, it's just like...
No. Like, there's no issue whatsoever. It's like,
I don't understand.
Why would anyone speak into the microphone?
I've done that demonstration on air for 8 years, man. Come on. Pedro's even getting pretty good at it.
When I saw you do it the first time, it's like, yeah, no, that's pretty obvious.
Now, like, if you wanted a microphone that you didn't, like, you could genuinely, like, talk into the side of, you would get something with, like, variable D giggity. That would be something from, like, Electro Voice. Like the RE20s.
Yeah, kernel 5.4. That's what I'm using.
I got 5.9 running right now. Not on
this
box.
Finally sorted.
No!
I was going to ask, did they finally sort the NVIDIA driver?
Silly boy, no. NVIDIA, that's a mini boss. You're dealing with Black Magic drivers. And they're like, 5.8? What are you talking about with that moon numbering? We don't support that yet. Five nine's fine. I just went ahead and installed it because I wanted to play, play's the accurate word with some of the updates to the FireWire ALSA stack. And it's getting there. It's getting... like even the Motu stuff especially is like you can develop some like genuine false hope, then it'll just die on you. But man, you're feeling it for like 45-50 minutes. You're like, this is gonna work. I'm like, okay, never mind, I'm sorry. Back to Fado.
Yeah, there's I think it was Mr. Alert and Mir. We're talking about it on Discord earlier today. Yeah, the NMU module just straight up doesn't build against 5.9.
Yeah.
419 on the surface, that's the last version with both multi-touch and pen. That, like I said, Strider, that is a magic kernel. That was the kernel that made the Steam box go from maybe booting sometimes and actually successfully getting into big picture mode, right, to reliably booting every single time with no issues. That was the kernel.
Yeah, these, well, no. Both of these boxes are running 5.7, I think.
For the RT patch. It builds, but it won't load. That's even worse.
You just need to go buy an AMD card.
I am waiting to see what AMD comes out with, and the independent reviews, obviously.
Fine, whatever. Maybe. I'm waiting for Intel to come out with it.
2021.
After the Intel's out, then I'm gonna have to wait for Nvidia though.
They say Nvidia might actually release, heavy air quotes around release, because yeah, the upgraded versions, like that 3080 with 16 gigs and the
Everybody thinks they're going to be okay. You got two ways you can do this. You can do what you're proposing, like, hey, we're going to, you know, release the equivalent of TIs and stuff like that, but that means they're going to have to cut prices. Nvidia does not like to cut prices. I think they're going to be offering chop shop versions of their entire line,
probably. Which is why I'm hoping AMD will have something.
No, they're going to have something with 16 gigajoules on it.
Yeah.
Other than the, what does the 3090 have? Does it have 16?
The 3090, doesn't that have 24?
24.
Because someone loaded the entire Crysis 3 into an NVRAM disk and ran the game. Let's see, 3090 VRAM. Yes, 24, yeah. 24. GDDR6X.
Man. Yeah, they're going to need something with, like, they're going to need a 2070. See, that's going to bite them, though, man. Like, if AMD really drops, like, something serious, then, like, the 2070... Who wants that at 8 gigs at $500?
The the 3070 is a $500 one. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You were saying 2070 and my brain was going, wait, what?
3070. We gotta start writing the right date on our checks.
Yeah, that's the one I'm looking into buying. I do want to see what the AMD numbers are, but I kind of want the CUDA cores on my new video card.
I really wouldn't be opposed to buying an AMD video card finally, but it has to be at the very least competitive.
Yeah.
Because the 5700 XT was a very good video card. It was priced right along the 2070 and the 2070 Super. And it performed kind of like a 2060 Super. So...
Yeah,
I know. It needs to be better than that.
So I was thinking getting a 5700 for my Mini.
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking of doing that. Is that I have a spare 580 and I've got a spare 1060. So that are mini cards too that would fit.
And yeah, just loading up Linux on the RX 570 in El Cheapo. You install it and it goes, oh yeah, no, that AMD video card.
Drivers yeah, I'm are all done. Set up. It's you can so easy.
Ready to go.
Yeah.
So I don't need to do anything. No. Okay.
Yeah, I love that. That's why I'm using the 580 right now. It's been a great card, very robust, and it's still great cards, and they're still selling.
Go to the small form factor
build
PC
a mini PC inside a 3090, Scott.
There's plenty of people with 3090s shoved in their little shoebox cases going, man, I want this thing to die sooner of a thermal death.
Oh, I know.
Yay, it's so small, you guys.
Yeah, and if the new GPUs don't impress, all I'm going to do is take the 1080 out of that case, take the screws, wipe the old paste because it's been there since 2015. put new paste and put it back together. Ta-da.
We're not as cool as Mr. Alert. We don't have 1080s. Well, I mean, Pedro
1080
does.
1080 Ti's. 350 1080 Ti's.
The, thermal paste? What are you, a peasant? Wait. Ugh.
For the actual GPU, everything else has thermal pads.
Ugh.
I didn't buy that tube of cryonaut specifically to that to not use it.
Man, I've probably bought like one, I think legitimately, I bought like the Arctic Silver 12, 13 years ago. Still got it.
Yeah, still have mine too.
I bought one of the 10, it's actually in the kitchen along with the rest of the thermal paste tubes inside the toolbox. Mm-hmm. I bought one of the 10 milligram cryonaut tubes. It was expensive, it's like the best paste. So, yeah.
The best.
Yeah. It's like 12 or 13 kelvins per meter squared, something like that.
Well, I inadvertently completed a real-life test of the graphene thermal pad. There it is. In Jackbox. Yep.
Nice.
After being squished into a 212 by almost a year and a half. And yeah, it's just fine. It gave negative cares when I pulled it off. And I'm like, yeah, hey.
Very good.
It's like, okay, I'm just gonna leave you there and put this one on now.
You're going back in.
Yeah, just, I picked it up, the pair of tweezers, and looked at it, and I was like, oh, cool.
Yep.
When I change out this Threadripper, now that they, any heatsink or any modification I'm making to that, that's getting, Cryonaut makes, Threadripper pads.
Yep.
Yeah. Like, done. I'm not using paste anymore. Like, but Vern, you can get an extra degree and a half off. Get bent.
Arthurin, yes, right up until you cook all the water and all the grease out of it, at which point it would just be carbon.
Toothpaste and mayo, man.
Toothpaste in a pinch, according to the internet, will do. But you don't want to keep it there for very long because it hardens very quickly.
Mm-hmm. We sense the whole thing, man. I mean, with most paste, I mean, yes, they have like non-curing stuff now, but anything that you're going to get like pack in, ship and stuff, maybe not with your Pooh Brown fans. I think.
Yeah, the Noctua paste is really nice.
Yeah, that's what I used on this one. But. You know, you still should be pulling that once a year because it's going to dry out well, but you're going to be losing some of your thermal conductivity.
Yeah. And I haven't taken the 1080 apart in 5 years because it's been working splendidly. Yeah, it's been fine. So.
Yeah, I usually put new thermal paste in them. The GPUs I use a lot every year. For one, when you're doing rendering, you really, as Ven knows, doing video editing, you really work that card hard. And there used to be a joke, you know, in the, it's still true, you know, today. There's a big joke between the animators. And like, okay, you got a budget for a new video card every year. Because we burn them out. I've burned out several. That's what happened to my 1060. It finally just burned out because I was using it a lot for rendering.
So. Well, most anybody doing professional rendering, and if they're doing it at home, they're not doing it on, they're using a render box, but they're, you're basically using a terminal at home nowadays.
Yeah.
That entire industry has taken a shift, especially with COVID. They finally get everything hammered out. You got,
yes.
You got a high-end box, but it's not at home anymore.
Well, there's some cases where you can't, if you modify your plugins and whatnot, that you can't use them in the cloud for rendering.
Well, it's also a chain of trust, a security issue too. Is another reason.
Yeah, and that's an issue.
That's why, like, what the software they're using right now, is talking to somebody who's actively in the industry now, and I forget the name of the fucking software they're using, but it's locked in. It works with my some Fusion stuff that they have. That's where the conversation gets started.
Yeah, and RenderMan is one we used to use heavily. That a lot of people still use,
but. Yeah, that's how we're handling it now. You know, it's effectively VPN into their box.
Yep.
Which also, for the security aspect of, like, you don't have that, those assets sitting at other people's houses randomly.
Yep.
It's all at work. I was like, that makes sense.
And just give them a cheap laptop they can plug into a dock to a couple of monitors if they need it, and they remote in.
Yep.
All right. It's almost 5:00. I gotta go work. I gotta convert this into audio bits and video bits.
Yes. And I need to go make something for dinner.
What?
No idea what yet, but
just go ahead, pop a chicken.
I'm starving.
Don't have chicken. All of the whole chickens. I was actually going to buy another one to try a slightly different variation of the recipe.
Right.
But they that particular section of the aisle was empty.
Empty.
it wasn't my tea hen, unfortunately. Would have loved to have met empty there, but no, it just had nothing.
So it was a gog steak it is.
Yeah, I grabbed steaks, grabbed some mince, grabbed beef mince and turkey mince. So mince? I can do mince meat.
Oh, okay. It really sounds like you're saying mince. I'm like,
Not mince. Mince.
So did you see
mash up the meats together.
Pedro, why don't you send that guy a low ball offer and see what we can get?
Oh, hello. That's cheaper than the other one. The other one was $149.
Let's see if we can low ball him a little bit.
Okay. Let's see. Make your offer.
I'll be glad to chip in.
I'd say 90?
90, all right.
Start with 90.
125, not bad.
125 is 125 pounds. That's about what they should be selling for. But that's not what they're selling for. It's like 150 pounds.
Mm-hmm. Nope, that was automatically rejected.
Oh, all right.
Why do you have make offers if you're not even going to let people make them?
Because they have a minimum make offer. Minimum bar set.
That's what I use. This is best bang for the buck microphone on the market, period. 100, hands down.
Okay, 100. Okay. 100 went through.
Writes you back, you're like, how about 99? That's a better principle. All right.
That's an interesting username, too.
What is the username?
Comrade.
Comrade. Comrade. Yeah. Okay.
K-O-M-R-E-D. Comrade. Yeah, it's
like one of my side projects is trolling UK eBay for microphones for page ones.
I saw that. Yeah, I found the other listing. Clearly someone had a studio or something with a bunch of them and they're selling them for 150. Yeah.
That's why they're so hard to get hold of, because studios just boom, wipe out stock. Because they're so cheap compared to, like, you know, SM7Bs or anything like that.
Mm-hmm. Mine.
Yeah, Aston made an interesting... That's the only dynamic mic Aston makes, but that one is set up to where it's kind of hard to mess up. You just plug in a XLR cable and go. And it's got two EQ curves on a switch, so hey, it works. It doesn't sound bad at all. So, and the most important thing, that's a good thing about like Jules Aston, is you don't need expensive hardware on the other end.
Yeah, built-in amp helps.
It's got an inline FET-based preamp, like a cloud. It's a cloud lifter built into it. So, same thing you'd run into with like a ribbon mic or most dynamic mics. That's why, that's one of the reasons I'm guessing there's such a high return rate on the Amazon dynamic mic. That little one. Because that thing needs like 53 dB to get up the level. I was like, what?
No.
Yeah.
I had to wind the focus rate like all the way up for just to get it up to the level, man. So I was like, yeah, a condenser mic would work a lot better. It's got a larger diaphragm on it than you would expect. So anyway, until tomorrow, I think Jordan and I are going to finish Wolfenstein.
Yeah, that was
cool. I
what
hope
Jordan
so.
Was saying on Saturday. So apparently you guys are the last level.
We had a hockey stick and Jordan came at me. I was fine after Jordan. Jordan's like, let's just try a different level. I'm like, that doesn't compete. That's not how Vin rolls. We will Groundhog Day this until we win.
I'm surprised you don't like Dark Souls.
You see, I like a challenge. I don't like it when it's just bad game mechanics.
VenAtleticsGameCast.com.
But that's not an unpopular opinion. Anybody who's actually good at video games says the same thing. See, that's how you get them. Get to use fan strats.
VenAtleticsGameCast.com.
All right. Scott, I don't get it. Ah, okay. See, that makes all kind of sense now, doesn't it? All right. Beautiful people, we'll see you tomorrow. Show Saturday, 8:30 Eastern time here on Twitch. If you're a patron, come hop in Discord. We'll be in the pre-show now early. Maybe you think? Yeah. Come hop into creep shows and wave hello and good night. All at the same time. You got two hands. Use them. Bye, everyone.
Mm-hmm. Bye, everyone.
That's...
Mm-hmm.